while. Let's now get to my favorite, and that's Altair. Altair is a relatively new package that uses the Vega Light Grammar. We already saw that when we used Voyager here. It's specified in JSON, which is then compiled to the Vega Grammar, and that's not specific to a certain programming language. And what Altair simply does is it lets us create these JSON specifications using a nice Python API that even nicely integrates with Pandas. So such that it creates this Vega Lite specifications, and then these Vega Lite specifications can be rendered in Jupyter. And we see, for example, if we have JSONs here, I can even, if I have the respective JupyterLab extensions, render them. If there were actual Vega Lite specifications, I could render them in Jupyter here. Okay, so let's get to the basic grammar of Altair at first. For that, let's reload our dataset here again and import Altair as ALT, which bears some resemblance to PLT. And how we specify stuff in Altair is we use these four building blocks. We tell Altair which data we want to use, which mark type we want to use, what transformations, if any, we want to apply, and how we want to encode the variables and the entire plot. Okay, so the transforms can be omitted when no transformations are needed. So taking the sum or taking the mean, we most of the time don't even want that. So we simply create a plot by saying, Altair, please make me a chart using the cast dataset. As mark type, I want ticks, and I want you to encode on the x-axis the horsepower of our chart cars. And this then will create this plot. We see Altair is not changed by importing Seaborn, so it doesn't use the Seaborn style. Okay, so this looks Pythonic because we have method chaining and actually calling methods with keyword arguments. However, if we compare this to ggplot, we see that the two grammars can actually be mapped to each other. So calling alt.chart corresponds to ggplot, which marks the beginning of the sentence of our grammar. This encode is basically the aesthetics, which specifies the mapping of data variables to aesthetics or channels, as they are called here in Altair. So this is a channel. And then the mark underscore something corresponds to the geom underscore something, which specifies which geometric objects we want to display. So this here is the same thing in ggplot. And here we see how Altair displays it and how ggplot displays it. I prefer Altair's variant here. Okay, and if we want to add other variables to the chart, we can simply add new encodings. So in our dot encode, so this is the same as we had before, but in our dot encode, we'd say, yeah, X should encode the horsepower and Y should encode the weight. Okay, for single chart, we are thus always restricted to a single mark type because we first specify the mark, and then on top of that, we say the encoding such that there's only one mark type here, right? So we can, to make a scatter plot, we can do it like this, but we can change the mark type. So this is the weight and the horsepower, and we have a scatter plot. We can change the mark type to circle, and then we can add another variable, which encodes, for example, which is encoded in color. So here color now codes the origin. Origin is a binary categorical variable, so that's really easy to do in color here. Now we have three variables on this one Altair plot. So again, this is also, it does use our standard grammar of graphics. I understand if you like this more than ggplot because the interface is more Pythonic. I like it more than ggplot, but it's still the basic same encoding. Okay, so in Altair, I have different data types, nominal, ordinal, quantitative, and temporal data, scalen niveaus if you had statistic. So it will automatically, intelligently infer the data type and take the appropriate scales of measurement for these variables, okay? If they are not correctly inferred, we can specify that ourselves. So, for example, by suffixing the variable with the first letter of the data type. So, please take horsepower as quantitative data, weight as well, and origin as nominal data. We don't have to do that here because it did that correctly, but we could do that if there would be the need for that. Or we could explicitly say type equals quantitative by specifying altair.x, altair.y, and altair.color. So again, this here stands only for the actual alt.x, y, or color objects. It's just a shortcut notation. Okay, Altair is embedded in Python, which means we can transform data in any way we like. So we can, for example, take here the mean. So this is simply then evaled again. So if we call this, what it under the hood does, that it takes our cast data set at the column weight in pounds, and then it takes the mean of that, right? And let's make it the np.mean, and this is basically automatically eval. So if I have eval and then I have a string, and then this will take the string and execute it as functions, and this is how this works under the hood in Altair as well. So it adds some more magic. So it adds np dot or whatever it uses for the mean, and that it wants the column weight in pounds from the dataset cast. But this is how it works under the hood. Okay, so we have aggregations here where we take the mean or we take the count. Now we can again go over all of the stuff we had before. So for example, if we want to encode using certain binning for a histogram, we have to use the more verbose alt.x class, where we can say, yes, I want you to bin. I could, using keyword arguments, provide the number of bins, etc. I could also, and now this is a syntax which makes it again look more like it looked in ggplot, I can make a two-dimensional binning here, which is now a two-dimensional histogram. Basically, we saw similar plots already in Seaborne or in ggplot. And yes, there are many transformations. Look at how they work here. So now there's this really nice feature in Altair, and that is that it provides an algebra for combining views. So faceting works by overwriting Python operators. So if I call the plus operator on two Altair charts, or on two complete Altair charts document, what's going to happen is it's going to put them onto different layers. So because the Vega Light grammar provides operators to combine plots in arbitrary ways using this layering, where I have two layers on top of each other, and also for vertical and horizontal concatenation, we can basically do that. So we can call the respective layering function in Vega Light using the plus operator in Python. So I have two plots which I want to plot on top of each other. I simply add them. And if I, so that's the same thing. It seems very verbose, but we can factor out common elements by letting, for example, so here, because we have to, this, for example, is the same in both, and that we want to encode on x, on the x-axis, the horsepower, we have to specify that for both. So these are common aesthetics, and I can abstract that away, factor out these common elements into this base chart. So I can make an altair.chart.encode x, and then from, I can assign that to the variable base, and then from that base, only the changes I want to have in my plot, in this respective plot, I can assign to chart 1 and chart 2, and then I can layer them on top of each other. Okay, so now plus means on top. I can make a concatenation using the pipe operator that puts them next to each other horizontally, and underneath each other vertically using the AND operator. And I can combine that. So this here creates a more complex plot, which is basically this entire thing here. And now if I say, and underneath that, I want this new scatter plot, which I created, I can do that by simply, well, the result of this, I want to combine with an AND using, with an AND to the scatter plot. And now I have three different plots here in one. And I can do hist, so I can put these underneath each other and then the scatter plot next to that, etc., etc. So if I want to create multiple plots where I only change one, for example, what's on the x-axis here for my plots, I can call the repeat, where I specify as x-axis I want this alt.repeat object, where I want to repeat on the columns, and then I call from the result of that, I call the method .repeat, and specifying which columns here I want to have on the x-axis, such that I have four plots at the same time here. I can repeat over both rows and columns to create this scatter plot matrix, which is basically, so using this I could create the entire seaborne pair plot, but it takes longer, more statements. Okay, so Vigalite is really modular, so we can use the same operations on compound charts we used on a unit chart, so we can do all that kind of stuff. We can combine that. Faceting works just like renew from ggplot, etc., etc. As much for the basic Altair stuff, it has all the features we've seen before. But the really, really nice thing about Altair is the new dimensions of interactivity. Okay, so the easiest thing we can do is we can make it interactive by simply calling .interactive. So if I don't call this .interactive, I have a normal plot and there's nothing I can do with it. If I call the .interactive method, I can already zoom using my scrolling wheel and pan using my mouse. So that's already as much interactivity basically as we had using Plotly. But there's much more. For example, we can select points of interest. And for that, I have the altair.selection single function here, which I call here selection. And then I say that I want to create a chart which is encoded in such a way such that the color is either, so depending on the selection, so depending on, so this will be true now for the one point which I selected because of selection.single, and the one point I selected is supposed to be colored by origin, and all the ones that are not selected, for which the condition selection is not true, are going to get the altair.value light gray, so the color light gray. And now I have to call .property selection equals and then my alt.selection single, such that this here gets assigned the type of selection I want to enable for this graph. And then I, of course, have to call .interactive because otherwise it's not interactive. And now if I have this plot, I can select one point, and now only this point will be in color and all others will be light gray. And this one point, so if I select nothing, all will be in color, but if I select one point, this will be color coded by origin. I can abstract or elaborate. I can show more or less details. So for example, I have here the full plot, and to the right, I have the more detailed plot. And the more detailed plot has what it has, where the X and Y scale or domain is specified by what I provided here in the left plot. So how does this work? Well, I have this alt.selection interval for the X and for the Y axis. And then I have two plots, which I, so this here is the first plot, the overview plot, and this here is the detail plot, the second one. Then I simply plot them next to each other. I create basically a figure which contains both of these axes, so to say. And then in the first plot, I have the normal chart where X encodes the horsepower, Y encodes the miles per gallon. And then the color is again coded as a condition here, such that every one which is not in our selection interval, yeah, so this must be true. So the point must be in our selection X and in our selection Y interval. And then our dot is color coded by origin, and otherwise it's light gray. And then we add those two selections to it such that we can, well, we have this functionality. You can see the scrolling wheel here does something. I didn't know it did. Wow. And then my second chart basically has the x-axis encoded in a scale which we take such that, so we take as the domain for the x scale and the y scale, we take what our selection x refers to. So we take the x and y, so the lower and upper boundary of both x and y as domain for our second plot here, such that if we change that in this plot, it will automatically set the respective domain in the second plot. And that's just really nice because now I have overview here in this one and details in this one. I can zoom in as much as I want. And it, so this is also against overplotting, because if I zoom in enough, it's not overplotting anymore because, well, I don't have that many points here on top of each other. Okay, I can show related items. So I can highlight items in this one plot and then show the same plots on other dimensions. So this here is a plot which plots acceleration against horsepower, and in this plot I can mark an interval here, and then the same interval will be, I can zoom in and zoom out here, and then only those points that fall into this interval of the acceleration versus horsepower plot are going to be plotted in color in the horsepower against acceleration, against displacement, or weight in pounds against acceleration, or weight in pound against displacement plots. Okay, so here I select, and then it prints me the same dots here, colors me the same dots in other plots. How do I do this? Well, I have the alt.selection function where I want to select an interval. And then I make simply a chart, which I don't combine two different charts here. I simply use my repeat function here, where I, well, want to repeat horsepower versus pound here, horsepower, weight, and here acceleration, displacement. And the color, again, is coded by the condition such that if my brush here, which is my selection tool, basically, so if this condition holds true, then color code it as the origin color, else color it in light gray. And now I can, in one plot of these, I can define my interval here, and this color coding of the interval is going to be used for all of the plots, because this is how under the hood this repetition for plots works. So I can do it in either of these plots and they're going to use the same interval. That's just a really, really nice thing. So I see, for example, all these American cars which are heavy and have a huge displacement are also, the acceleration is rather scattered, but by the weight I know already that, but here I see them in the other plots. What do I do here? Oh yeah, that's select multi, where I select, if I select one of these points, I select all of the points which have the same origin. So I have this selection multi for the field origin, and I color code them with the condition here that those which correspond to the selection, where, because I have the selection multi here, will select all which are from the same origin, will code by color, otherwise we'll code them in light gray. And this is also a nice way to prevent overplotting, because even though there are less Japanese cars here, now I can only show the Japanese cars and let them stand out. Alright, and then I think this is already the last thing I want to show, yes, and that is that I can show something conditionally, so I can filter. That allows me to view arbitrary subgroups of our dataset in a new context. And that's just, I think, the nicest thing about Altair here, and the thing I showed you at the very beginning. So I can select something here, and this now is a filter such that only for the interval I'm providing here, I want I only want to consider these sample points for my histogram here. And the same here again for one dimension and the histogram. So how does this work? Well, I again make my brush, which is an alt.selection of the type interval. And then I have two plots again, so the points and the bars, and I horizontally concat. So this here is another possibility of how to concatenate two plots in Altair. And I simply have the encoding here that, again, the color of the left plot is coded by our brush condition here. And then in the bars, I simply encode that I encode them normally. I want, for the x-axis, I want the origin, and for the y-axis, I want count. I want to color code them by the origin, but I have the transform filter with the brush here, such that now it only takes into account those points for which my brush condition here is true. Now I can specify my brush here. I can use my scrolling wheel here. Now I see that, for example, so in the higher miles per gallon range, there are actually only European Japanese cars. And then the lower I get, the more American cars I have. Oh, jeez. That's extreme. Yeah, and I can do the same if the left one is two-dimensional and also don't need this horizontal concat. I can also do it in our standard way of how we saw it before. So I have my brush, which is an art selection of type interval. I color code here and I add selection of the brush here. I color code the dots here by my condition. And in the bar plot again, I use the transform filter. So if I want to have the next to each other, it works just as well. And now I can select points here, and the selection is going to be automatically in the white graph as well. I really like Altair. These features of Altair are really awesome. It's really easy to create interactive plots in Altair. This is why I'm showing you, and it also basically, so it has these nice features. So there are these three things I like about it. Well, obviously that it's nice how to create interactive plots. The Vega Lite specification is really great, and that they are that easily interactive. So for more interactive plots, see the user guide here. And again, so because the Vega Lite JSON thingy can easily be exported to HTML, I can simply .save my plot to an HTML, and now, so I can open this in my browser. In my browser, I just need the full path. Oops. And that's here. So render.html, it looks a bit different, but it still provides the same features because this is basically, so this is how Vega Lite is specified in HTML5. So it's a Vega embed here. So I see this is the Vega Lite specification here. And that looks differently if I rendered in the browser or in JupyterLab. I could probably make that the same, but I don't know how. All right, so that's it for this lecture. I really showed you a lot, but then again, I don't want you to know everything of this by heart. I just want you to know these are nice things. The homework are gonna be about those plots you already know for different data sets. So there's nothing new you should learn. There's of course new you should learn, but there's nothing new you need here. Just apply the stuff here. Copy the ones you know already, because this is what I want you to do, to copy the ones you know already. Yes, and then I have a lot of further readings or other YouTube videos here about everything. And like I said, the Vega Lite, the Altair is from Jake Vanderplas, from whom many of our lectures are. Really worth watching. Cool guy. And that's it for this lecture. Bye bye.